Daniel chapter 2 without Hannah. Welcome and thank you for joining us. In this brief study, we will be comparing the vision of Daniel chapter 2 with the vision of Daniel chapter 7. We will see in particular that some of our key points of faith are described in Daniel chapter 2. We'll see the investigative judgment brought to view, as well as what happens during and after the thousand-year period of Revelation chapter 20. Firstly, let's remind ourselves of how the earthly kingdoms described in Daniel 2 are the same as the earthly kingdoms described in Daniel 7. The vision in Daniel 2 describes a statue made of different metals, and it begins with the head of gold, which represents the Babylonian Empire. This parallels the first beast described in Daniel 7, which is like a lion and also represents Babylon. Next, in Daniel 2 comes the chest and arms of silver, and in Daniel 7, the next beast is like a bear. These both represent the Medo-Persian Empire, which went on to conquer Babylon. After this, the belly and thighs of brass in the statue parallel the third beast in Daniel 7, which is like a leopard, and these both represent the Grecian Empire. And then in Daniel 2 are the legs of iron, and when we compare it with Daniel 7, it's the fourth dreadful and terrible beast. Both represent the Roman Empire. Finally, the feet and toes of the image are described as a mixture of iron with miry clay. The iron in it shows that really it's the same kingdom, but with an element that has come in which has now made it divided. Likewise, in Daniel 7, when another little horn comes up, having eyes like the eyes of man and a mouth speaking great things. A simple study can show that the feet and toes of iron and clay and the little horn on the dreadful and terrible beast both represent a second phase of the same kingdom of Rome. This phase of the empire went on to be known as the Holy Roman Empire or Papal Rome. Now, after Daniel 2 describes all these earthly kingdoms, the scene changes, and what is next seen is a stone being cut out of a mountain without hands. And the phrase without hands means it is describing the work of God and not man. Interestingly, but not surprisingly, Daniel 7 does the same thing. After describing the four earthly empires, the spectacle changes to a judgment scene in heaven where the Ancient of Days sits and the books are opened. This scene is describing the work of God and not man, and a simple study can show that this scene in Daniel 7 is representing the investigative judgment just prior to Christ's second coming. This study suggests that these two scenes in Daniel chapter 2 and Daniel 7 are both describing the same event. Now, just as the earthly kingdoms parallel in Daniel chapter 2 and 7, so too does the work done by God in both chapters. That is the work of the investigative judgment. So what clues do we have in the imagery of Daniel 2 itself that would suggest that the stone being cut out of the mountain is describing the work of the investigative judgment? Well, the imagery in Daniel 2 uses a mountain, a stone, and a work which is done without hands. A mountain usually represents a kingdom in Bible prophecy, and has been used elsewhere in the Bible to represent God's people on earth. Daniel chapter 9, Joel chapter 2 verse 1, Jeremiah 17 verse 1, and Micah chapter 4 verse 1. Note that in some of these verses, when God uses a mountain to describe his people, they are not all in a good or faithful condition. Stones are also used in the Bible to represent God's people too, and often in connection with a temple. Isaiah chapter 51, verse 1, Exodus chapter 28, 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 5, and 1 Corinthians 3, verse 16. As we briefly mentioned before, the phrase without hands points to a work that is carried out by God and not man. Elsewhere in the scripture, the phrase without hands points to a work carried out by Christ. Colossians chapter 2 verse 11 and Mark chapter 14 verse 58. And in 2 Corinthians 5 verse 1 and Hebrews 9:24, the idea of without hands is used in direct connection with the heavenly sanctuary. Since the investigative judgment is carried out in the heavenly sanctuary by God and not by man, we can safely say that it would be consistent for the Bible to be describing this work done as without hands. In Daniel chapter 2, in parallel with the investigative judgment scene of Daniel 7, we can see a group of God's people described as a stone gradually separated from a wider group of God's people described as a mountain. Given the context of Daniel 7, the stone would include all the righteous from Adam down to the last saint saved before Christ comes. So too, the mountain would symbolize all the unsaved who have professed Christ from Cain down to the last unsaved professed Christian before Christ comes. In Matthew 22, when the king comes in to see the guests at the wedding, he makes a distinction between the good and the bad and separates them. So in the investigative judgment, the stone is separated from the mountain by God. A distinction is thus made between those who professed to be the people of God and those whose character is like Christ and their sins are blotted out as a result. Many are called, but few are chosen. With Daniel 2 running parallel with Daniel 7, the stone therefore could not be a few select people at the end of the world, which some have suggested, but the stone would represent all the ransomed saints that have ever lived upon this earth from the beginning of time all the way to the close of human probation. Once the stone has finished being cut out, the stone smites the image upon the feet, and all the image, the iron, the clay, the brass, the silver, and the gold are broken to pieces together at the same time and destroyed forever, and there is no place found for them. The next scene which parallels this in Daniel 7 is the destruction of the little horn and the mention of a final end to the lives of the other beasts. In the interpretation of Daniel 7, it is described as a judgment being given to the saints of the Most High, and they take away his dominion to destroy and to consume it to the end. Daniel chapter 7, verse 26. Now it's interesting to consider, when does the breaking of the image in Daniel 2 occur? Well, it occurs at the end of the 1,000 years in its fullest sense. Daniel 2 verse 35 tells us that once they are destroyed and broken together, there is no place found for them. This same phrase is used in Revelation chapter 20, verse 11. Bearing in mind the context of Revelation 20 is the 1,000-year judgment scene in heaven, see verse 4. And then at the end of the 1,000 years, fire comes down from God out of heaven, see verse 9. And then in verse 11, it summarizes it by saying, there was no place found for them. That is, the wicked have all been destroyed by fire. And once that's completed, there is no place found for them anymore upon the earth. So Daniel chapter 2 verse 35, when the stone breaks the image, is actually pointing to the breaking of all earthly nations by fire in the destruction of all nations together at the close of the 1,000 years. Zechariah chapter 12, describing the work of the saints during this time, says, "And in that day will I make Jerusalem a burdensome stone for all people, and all that burden themselves shall be cut in pieces." That day is the end of the 1,000 years. God will use his people in the judgment of the wicked during the 1,000 years. Let's notice this summarized in Psalms 149, verse 5-9. "Let the saints be joyful in glory. Let the high praises of God be in their mouth, and a two-edged sword in their hand, to execute vengeance upon the heathen and punishments upon the people. Bind their kings with chains and their nobles with fetters of iron, to execute upon them the judgment written. This honor have all his saints." Then the vision of Daniel 2 finishes with the stone filling the whole earth and becoming a great mountain. Well, what takes place in Daniel 7 after the judgment sits and the wicked nations are consumed and destroyed? What takes place? Daniel chapter 7 verse 27 in the next verse says, "And the kingdom and dominion and the greatness of the kingdom under the whole heaven shall be given to the people of the saints of the Most High, whose kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and all dominions shall serve and obey him." This is the saints being given the earth made new after the destruction of the earthly kingdoms. So here we see that Daniel 2 and Daniel chapter 7 tell us the same story, not only for the earthly kingdoms, but also for the kingdom of God. So let's review what we have seen in this brief study. Number one, the four kingdoms of Daniel 2 are the same as the four kingdoms of Daniel 7. Number two, the stone being cut out without hands represents the work of the investigative judgment. Number three, the saints in judgment play a part in the smiting of the image. The destruction of the image and all earthly kingdoms occurs at the end of the 1,000 years. Number four, the stone which fills the earth represents the saints filling the earth made new at the close of the great controversy. I pray that as you review Daniel 2, you will see the truth of God shining clearer than ever before as you place it side by side with Daniel chapter 7. I also pray that those watching will be a part of this stone cut out during this time of the investigative judgment without hands. May God bless you in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.